All right, joining us on our second Hot Copy, it's a privilege to have him back on Head Start. We have former Philippine Senator Richard Gordon. He was once the chairman of the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee and still sits as the head of the Philippine Red Cross. Senator Gordon, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen. Good to be back. Thank you.
All right, before we talk about Chacha, I want to ask you, the hottest issue right now is the West Philippine Sea. What should we be doing right now? Should we change strategy? What are your thoughts about China's latest aggression?
Well, they're getting too aggressive. And the one thing that I'd like to remind our country is we have to assert our claim on our international our waters. No? And to do that, it's too late in the day, but we still have time. We cannot just say modernize the armed forces. We've been saying that for the last 30 or 40 years. At the very least, I would suggest right away, it's kind of reckless, is to have our own squadron of F-16s, which will take about a year or two before you can establish that, so that anytime they harass us, we can do a flyby of this high performance just to let them know, makakabalik tayo sa kanila, we can hit them back. No? In which case, if they escalate, then you go back to the mutual defense pact within the United States. No, but the point is, I was listening to your earlier dialogue with Commodore Tariella. Really, it's a cul-de-sac. If you keep on maintaining Sierra Madre, first, if you ask for escort services from our allies, they cannot do that forever. And at the same time, unless we decide, all right, there's a proposal that the Americans say, if you rebuild it, we will provide military support. Or I don't know whether I'm being...
Escort. Accurate.
Yeah, uh-oh. Escort to make sure that you can rebuild the ship. No? Kung magre-rebuild ka rin labang ng ship, then let's do a platform na talaga na nakasama yung ship, maglayo ka na rin, mag-reclaim ka na rin. No? Or explore the reed bank.
Mm-hmm.
That's what even more important to us because we need the oil. And if we do that, even assign, let's say, to an American contractor, doble-doble bukol na yan because they will be, matching loggerheads with America when it comes to really getting oil from the reed bank, which is also disputed. Now, let us be prepared, as the Vietnamese were prepared, in 1988, they lost lives. 63 Vietnamese died in an encounter. We have to know that. And yet they didn't go to war. No? Although they did go to war when China attacked Vietnam right after the Vietnamese War. But they went to war, actually, on two occasions. In 1988, 64 Vietnamese died. And then again in 1974, if I'm not mistaken, in the Battle of the Paracel Islands, another 63 Vietnamese died. In a clash with China. It did not escalate into a full-blown war. And interestingly enough, here comes Xi Jinping. Akin mo talaga, doon ako naiinis eh. They tell us we are friends. They tell us, we have good alliances, traditional alliances, and yet they speak with a forked tongue. You know, they water cannon our small fishermen, they ram our boats. Aba, hindi pwede yan. Kailangan talaga mag-assert tayo. The mistake was we never built up our armed forces in spite of the last 40 years, but ayoko na yung modernize. Right away, put something there that is credible. You know, whether it's F-16s or some high-performance aircraft that can match them or that can at least go on even terms, in which case you can fall back on the Mutual Defense Treaty as well as the other agreements that we're trying to get with our allies. But if we do... If we do something about read back, then I'm sure, all this razzmatazz about the international rules-based order will come into play. And most important, that sticks in the craw of everybody, is national interest of all countries who pass by the West Philippine Sea or the so-called China Sea or that body of water, and they want international rules-based order in that area so that the trade will not be impeded, oil will flow all the way from the Middle East to the Philippines and to China and to Japan. And that's what this is all about. And that is always what has been maintained by the U.S. Navy through the Seventh Fleet.
Okay. Now, Senator, I want to ask you this because Commodore Tariela has said there have been different suggestions, right? When they resupply, they're using indigenous boats and also commercial boats in which the China Coast Guard, I believe, grazed or hit one of the boats where General Browner was in one of those boats. So it's still considered a military operation because they're resupplying to military men, right? Because it's still military men in Sierra Madre and in Ayungin. So would it make a difference, do you believe? Would China's behavior be different if when the Philippines resupplies, we are resupplying openly with a military vessel?
That is a military operation. You're trying to resupply a military contingent of the Philippines in that vessel, which is still considered part of the list of military equipment of the Philippines. And I will say something about that. You know, while I commend General Browner, I think he's a very good officer, for bravery, I thought that was kind of reckless. That was my initial response, no? In all fairness. Because supposing he was rammed and he died, what happens now? Will there be a war? Will that trigger the mutual defense pact? I'm sure that will. Because why go there when
you in a commercial boat?
The commercial boat is just like the Sea Lift Command of the U.S. military. They have all these vessels that are under their supervision, the Sea Lift Command, or they retain commercial vessels when they get supply to their fleet. No, although most of the time it's done by the military Sea Lift Command. But still, it is still in pursuit of the national interest of resupplying our troops in that area. In fact, we're really, really overstretching our carefulness by coaching it as a commercial operation. But really, it's still a military operation because the ultimate objective is to resupply the soldiers, our soldiers, in that area.
Uh-oh. So that's a very good point you're making there. So technically speaking, what would have been more appropriate for General Browner's stature and position? What vessel should he have been in?
Well, you could use a Coast Guard. You could use they're doing the right thing. They could get a bigger commercial vessel to get in. And if they ram it, then so be it. There will be casualties. I'm not being reckless. It's just the point is, how much are we willing to go to stake our claim and to protect our claim and to protect our soldiers? On the other hand, how much is China willing to go? Because any attack on any military personnel there or assets, including a commercial vessel under contract with the Philippine government, could trigger off the Mutual Defense Pact. And we can say, oh, we have been attacked. America, come to our help. And to me, this is a chicken game, a very reckless chicken game being implemented by China when they keep on trying to goad us into becoming more reckless than they are. As far as I'm concerned, they have not gotten bajo de masilok, although they have physical possession, because they'll be able to enforce it. If we really want to do something about it, then get bigger Coast Guard vessels. If you use a Philippine Navy vessel, then that becomes very, very different scale. War na yan. Kasi that was the mistake of President Aquino, God rest his soul, when he sent a Philippine Navy vessel, the old Coast Guard vessel, the Hamilton class, during that effort. Then we had to back down because China sent its own naval vessels. That's why China puts in everything, the whole caboodle. They have Coast Guard vessels, and they have the so-called civilian fleet, which are all part. Remember that. All Chinese vessels, fishing vessels, are all part of the Chinese military.
Okay. So what do we do next? I mean, in the last few years, we've seen, of course, this president is quite firm in his statements from day one, and to the point he's exercised all diplomatic means, even speaking to President Xi Jinping at the APEC summit. You have another note verbal, of course, issued. There are hundreds already issued by the Philippines against China's behavior. What can we do differently? So you've said, one, explore the reed bank. Even former Senior Associate Justice Antonio Carpio has said that. Explore the reed bank. But what else can we do, Senator?
Well,
to
diplomatically,
exercise our sovereignty and jurisdiction in the area.
You know, what has happened to ASEAN? Wala na yung ASEAN eh? Because yeah, mainland ASEAN members would not do anything because they're right next to China. But you can strengthen Indonesia. We can strengthen Vietnam. Vietnam is also asserting its claim in some oil facilities there. And if we can reinforce each other, where our interests are not in collision, we can work with Vietnam, you know, because, you know, see, Vietnam was very, very strong. They had already sacrificed not just treasure, but blood. They lost a significant number of soldiers, and that could have escalated into a war. I don't know if they have a mutual defense pact with America, but if that had happened to us, America would surely, you know, according to their incantations, loosely, they would come to our support. And so, sa akin, we must be ready to shed blood. I mean, I know it's easy to say. You know, doon ako nagagalit on sa mga statement ng previous president na I'm not ready to lose Philippines. That is the job of the armed forces, to protect the country and the territory. And speaking of the Constitutional Convention, that's another thing that we have to amend. Foreign military bases, troops, or facilities shall not be allowed unless there is a treaty. Are you going to say time out? Magti-treaty muna kami para pumasok yan? Of course, there's already the treaty, mutual defense pact. But still, speaking about using all the marbles, we have to indicate, amend the Constitution, buy a squadron of high-performance jets better than the Korean jets that we have. I have a flyover there when the Chinese Coast Guard are doing that, you know, execute a maneuver like Tom Cruise.
But what do you think that will make a difference in China's behavior?
No, it will not.
Yeah, exactly.
It will not, but at least they will show we're firm, we're ready to shed blood. And remember, America and our allies will help us if we fight for ourselves. They're helping Ukraine. They don't have American troops there, but they help Ukraine because Ukraine is fighting back. Israel is being helped by the Americans because they're fighting back. And if I may be so sarcastic, we were ahead of Israel in 1948, was when they got their independence, and look at them. They have become one of the most powerful militaries in the world. Singapore is the same thing. Why can we never make an assertion na we will tighten our belts, lahat tayo magtitipid, lahat tayo alisin ng corruption, kukunin ng taxes sa customs, the BIR, magtitipid tayo, para we can finally have a very, very significant, not a modernized, but an effective military force that will get the attention of China.
Okay. Now, you have been through so many presidents, I would say maybe as a senator, as a sitting senator, from the time of from the time of after ERAP, GMA, right? So yeah. You've already, as a senator, so at least already.
The Secretary of Tourism, I was in the cabinet.
Yes, yeah. So ang tanong ko dito kasi is China has been consistent, in fact, to the point that they have reclaimed so many islands already. And it's like the Philippines woke up. It's like, oh, wow. It's now, there's a tarmac, there's a military base. So one, China's been consistent. Number two, from the 9-line, they're now extended to the 10-line.
Right.
The Philippine stand today is not to escalate, to, as Commodore J. Tariela said, just patiently, resupply. What are your thoughts about where we are today, considering you know the history of the issue with the West Philippine Sea? You were already a senator then.
We were good until we removed the military bases.
Mm.
They would not dare touch Scarborough Shoals. We were in control. In fact, Congressman Ablan put up the Philippine flag there in the Scarborough Shoals.
Interesting. So your stand today is really... meaning the U.S. bases in Subic. Is that what you meant?
Deterred China from doing anything. Clark and Subic deterred China from doing anything.
Okay, go on.
You say that there is a patience game being played by the Philippines. No, it's China testing the patience of the Philippines. How far are we willing to go? I reverse it. How far is China willing to go? If we say, all right, we're going to have action there, and we're going to put our money where our mouth is, and we're ready to train our people to be able to have a dogfight with Chinese planes, or to have our Coast Guard, a bigger Coast Guard, let's say, or even get 10,000 fishing vessels to go there, or 1,000 fishing vessels to go there, escorted by a Coast Guard, who will now be the big bully? They will still be the big bully, but it all started when we removed the bases. It got exacerbated by the fact that, you know, when President Duterte said, no, it's just a scrap of paper, yung nanalo tayo sa arbitral ruling, and they said, we cannot do anything when they take over Scarborough Shoals or when they take over Mississippi, and they put an Air Force field near Palawan, 90 miles away from Palawan. My gosh, we are in danger more than we think. Tomorrow, we can wake up and the Chinese are already in Palawan. Like the Abu Sayyaf raided the Dos Palmas a few years ago when I was Secretary of Tourism, wala tayong nagawa. You know, if President Kennedy were alive, or at least some kid in the Philippines would say, Why the Philippines Slept should be another book. Kennedy wrote Why England Slept. That was a prelude to World War II. And what was the thesis there? England, after World War I and the French, did not rearm. They did not modernize. Germany rearmed. The British never rearmed. So, and the French never rearmed. So they may have had more forces. But you know, when it comes to a very, very selfish, greedy neighbor like Hitler, or for that matter, with all due respect to Mr. Xi Jinping, I don't believe him. I believe the Chinese people. When they want something, they will use force. Never think that they're going to be nice to us. That is why we have to make sure that we have to have not just a credible, but a visible, effective armed force that can at least fight back. And when that happens, that's when the mutual defense pact kicks in.
Okay. All right. Now let's move on to different issues just very quickly. You were once chairman of the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee. I'm curious, what are your thoughts on this? We're speaking of treaties. Do you believe that the president can make a unilateral decision to go back to the International Criminal Court to rejoin the ICC, or because President Duterte withdrew from it, you now have to go through the process and you need Senate concurrence?
I don't think so. There was not an effective withdrawal, because if the Senate confirmation was needed or concurrence was needed when Duterte, we went to ICC, Duterte did it on his own. And there were disagreements amongst us. So if President Marcos says, no, we're back to ICC, that was a mistake, fine. We can do that right away. I don't have to go through that razzmatazz that we have to involve the Senate all over again. I think the Filipino people, again, that's like the mutual defense pact. If the justice system cannot defend our people, then the ICC comes in and says, and it's not an intrusion on our sovereignty, because an agreement like that is part of the law of the land in our constitution. And therefore, that's an extra layer of protection, so that when you have all these killings being perpetrated and nobody is brave enough to fight back, then you still have that. I'm in favor of that. I think President Marcos can go there and say, we, ICC, we're back.
Okay. My next question is, there's talk about charter change. Well, in the lower house, it started there. Your colleagues in the Senate, they're a bit lukewarm. Charter change isn't new. When you were senator, this was thrown and suggested over and over again. What are your thoughts today?
One thing that we must do, and we have charter change again, in fairness to my friend, Speaker Robaldez, it may be needed, but he must show the need. What is needed to be changed? And we have to be sure. Ito lang ang papalitan. Because once you open it in, let's say, a constitutional convention, it has a life of its own. It can change anything. Especially if it's a constitutional convention where you elect delegates to that. I was a member of the constitutional convention in 1971. And I was the youngest delegate that time. So we were going all over the place, amending this, amending that. So are we amending?
And that can happen again.
That can happen again. Right. So we must be very, very clear. Do you want to amend Section 25 of the transitory provisions on basing and bringing troops, because we now have a different scenario. You see, that's why
our constitution,
we have to be flexible. Flexibility is important. Otherwise, they'll use it against us, or the enemies of the state will use it against us, or people who are partial to China. And we have a lot of that here. Even Rafael Lunan is saying there's already a fifth column here, remembering what happened in Japan, in Davao, where they had Japanese farmers, you know, even earlier than that. But the point is, you want to amend the Constitution, are you going to overhaul it, or are you going to amend? Which amendment will you are you going to introduce? Is that necessary? Is that going to distract us from our agenda? To my mind, again, we could use it as a signal. For example, if we say we will now remove that clause on foreign military bases and troops, so that we now have more flexibility to invite foreign troops in our country, because we are not adequately prepared to invite to fight for ourselves. But again, I remind everybody, nobody's going to fight for us except ourselves. And if we're not ready to fight for ourselves, nobody's going to help us.
All right, sir, we have 2 minutes to go. I want to ask you, as chairman of the Philippine Red Cross, let's talk about what's happening right now in Gaza. There was a ceasefire, but of course, Israel has resumed the attack so far. Just what has the Red Cross been doing in that space in Gaza right now?
Well, there are several facets to it. The Palestinian Red Crescent is the one principally involved there, under the civil agreement among the Red Cross societies. But on the other hand, the ICRC is the principal Red Cross arm in terms of conflict. So they will be the ones in front. But it doesn't stop the Philippines, and we are now in the process. I was just in Hanoi 2 weeks ago, and we were asked whether we could send the Philippine doctors there. And I said, we already have 35 doctors ready, and I've been talking to some government officials that we could send doctors, but I did not agree that they would go to a Palestinian hospital that has tunnels underneath or whatever there is underneath. Well, I want to have a standalone camp, standalone hospital to take in the women and children. In fact, I gave a very impassioned speech in Hanoi, and everybody agreed. And when I said, we cannot just watch, we have to do what has been always our purpose, and that is to alleviate human suffering, especially the women and children and all the others dying there and being wounded there, not only in Israel, but also in Gaza. So what are we doing there? We're now preparing. In fact, I answered the letter of the Egyptian formally, Red Crescent, because they're the ones who are going to put it up. I even suggested, you remember in our your program,
yeah,
I said,
yeah,
we should do this, and we should even send a ship from the IFRC or the ICRC.
Yes.
We can even retain an old cruise ship and put it there, because they would have 4,000 camarotes there, and they would have cooking facilities, they would have hospital facilities, and that at least will allow ships to be isolated from the bombing.
Uh-oh. What's happened there so far?
The French are, I think, sending a ship. Uh-oh. And so far, the Emirates and Jordan have doctors and hospitals in where the hospitals are at. I would not send Filipinos to where Israel continues to bomb, because they feel that there are Hamas there. I would build a new facility near Egypt with a tent. We have done that in Yolanda. We put up a full-fledged hospital with the Canadians. We still have that. And if we're going to be asked, I have an agreement with Canada and Finland that we will send field hospitals with Filipino doctors, nurses, and medical technicians, so long as they're standalone, and so long as it is only for patients, and we will not allow families to go in there, because that will invite bombing.
All right. Okay. Well, please let me know if you do that. It might be interesting to actually document that as well and do a story on that. Before we go, this is just personal curiosity on my end. Are you planning to run again for office in the midterms? I know it's a bit off right now, but why not? You're here.
Let me be honest. There's been never a day when I'm not asked when I go out in public.
I know, yeah.
They ask me that. To my mind, let's see, because
Okay.
the last elections were very disastrous because the president, whom I'm still going after, by the way, formally.
Yeah.
Formally, it's not over as far as I'm concerned. We must prosecute Mr. Duterte. We must prosecute Michael Yang, who is a tool of the Communist Party of China, who probably executed the shift towards China. To my mind, that is something that is not off the table. It's still on the table, but I'm not going to say whether I'm going to run as yet.
Okay. On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining me today, former Senator Richard Gordon. Be well, sir, and you look great. Thank you.
Thank you. Likewise.